Most people got to know Ralph Wiley through his reporting for Sports Illustrated and ESPN. But Ralph was also a loving father, role model, and mentor to a generation of sports journalists. Ralph, as one friend said, possessed a unique elixir of passion, reason, wry wit, and black consciousness that stirred, moved, even angered those lucky enough to be touched by his words.
The way Muhammad Ali, the way Arthur Ashe, the way Billie Jean King all use sports as a way to make cultural statements and a way to really change history. I think Ralph Wiley also saw sports in that same light.
You knew that if Ralph Wiley disagreed with you, he was gonna say so, and he was gonna say why, and he was not going to flinch or back up one inch. Ralph Wiley was always about the truth, and the truth, it won't set you free, it will make you free. He understood that.
His voice was loud, but that's because Ralph woke up angry. He let the anger take him in these certain directions to find people, to connect with people, to tell their stories, to tell his own story.
Got to look at Ralph Wiley as the godfather. I mean, where would we be without Ralph, without him out there doing it, really advancing the cause and staying true to his self? You know, he was really a trailblazing pioneer for black sports writers.
Ralph Haygood Wiley Jr. was born in an African-American enclave of Memphis, Tennessee, called Orange Mound, on April 12, 1952. Even as a child, he struck his family as precocious.
He was very observant. Always he was looking.
I remember him as inquisitive. He wanted to know about everything. How does that work? Why is that way?
He was forever checking the bookcase to see what was new. And at one point in that child's life, I don't think he really cared what it was. He'd just read, just get a book and read.
In a childhood defined by curiosity, Ralph became aware that all around him swirled a revolution for racial justice, a revolution violently resisted at every turn.
If you look at Ralph Wiley growing up outside of Memphis, there still are colored and white drinking fountains. There still is school segregation. You're looking at people like Bull Connor beating heads in Birmingham. You've got the events on the Edmund Pettus Bridge in Selma where state troopers in Alabama literally attack people who are simply marching peacefully to ask for their right to vote. This is the world of Ralph Wiley as a child. This is a bitterly divided and racist society.
You can look from your house and see the white neighborhood. You can see the houses. You can see the people. But you went around that neighborhood. You would be chased. If caught, you could be beaten.
Given the hostility and the threat of violence from the larger white community, black Americans in this environment in the South essentially created a cocoon. A cocoon that was neighborhood and family and friends and their own social structures, from fraternities to schools. It was a black society.
It was close-knit. Everybody knew everybody. And I think it embodied the old phrase that it takes a community to raise a kid. And that took place.
The black lawyer was there. The black doctor was there. The black engineer was there. Everybody was there who served as a role model. There were these high standards that you could see and touch and feel every day.
And the cornerstone of that loving, thriving community that Ralph Wiley's family raised him in was the Mount Pisgah Church.
Ralph came out of a family steeped deeply in that Methodist church, which was only two blocks from his house. One of his aunts was a great musician. She was very instrumental in that church.
Ralph was fortunate to have music all around him. When you're around music and good music, I think you're able to sustain yourself through a lot of bad times.
Church was a very important part of his life. It's once again, O God, that a few of your children have gathered here in the Mount Pisgah CME Church to worship and praise your holy name.
Learn a lot about the Bible and what makes good people and what doesn't.
Though the neighborhood high school Ralph attended was segregated, the staff provided and expected no less than the best.
Merrill's was the best school in the city of Memphis. We had black teachers and black principals and the guidance counselors. They tried to help you achieve your goals.
Ralph was probably the smartest student there. He seemed to be a little bit ahead of everyone else in that class.
No matter what it was that was going on, Ralph was always writing something. So it seemed as if just the writing itself was a gift.
He'd take his little notepad out of his pocket, and if he liked something you said, he'd write it down. And it was a long time before I caught on to what he was doing. I said, what are you writing? He said, all this stuff you telling me.
Ralph was an unusual boy. He seemed to always know where he wanted to go, what he wanted to do.
But in his sophomore year, Ralph's life would be permanently altered when Dr. Martin Luther King came to Memphis seeking social justice.
Sanitation workers, all black, were among probably the worst treated urban workers in the South. And they struck for better working conditions. They asked King to come and support them.
And of course, it's in that environment then that he goes to give his mountaintop speech.
So I'm happy tonight. I'm not worried about anything. I'm not fearing any man. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord.
It was just the brilliant and beautiful musings of a very weary warrior.
And it's after he gives us that speech, of course, the next day that he's assassinated.
Martin Luther King was shot and was killed tonight in Memphis.
There's a sense of outrage that erupts across America, especially in urban America. There's a new jolt of energy into those who say, we've got to stand up, say who we are, and take what's ours right now. That is the spirit, then, that Ralph is so attracted to as he's growing up.
Ralph's anger led to action when, in his junior year at Melrose High, he became a leader of a movement called Black Monday, a boycott of Memphis schools to protest racial inequities.
Ralph was one that could command a walk out of the school.
He saw an opportunity to be a part of a great movement. If it's no more than picking up a telephone and said, look, we're not going to school Monday.
He had the personality to be persuasive. He had the temperament to be persuasive.
He told me, if Martin Luther King can lay down his life for us so that we can live better, the least I can do is help start something on this campus. And he did that.
Graduating from high school in 1971, Ralph's political convictions played a crucial role in his decision to reject a scholarship from a prestigious Ivy League school to go to a traditionally black college.
When Ralph Wiley turns down Brown to go to Knoxville, this is a period in which he would have viewed Brown as alien territory, that you're going up there to be somebody's black boy, that you're going up there in order to fit the needs of a university that wants a few polite black people around so they can say that they're integrated in the aftermath of the assassination of Dr. King.
He needed to find a place where he would be free to express his opinions, develop his thoughts, in an environment that wasn't going to criticize and castigate him right from the jump.
You're in an environment where they're saying to you, we know what you're talking about because we've been through it. We're one of you. This is your family. And because of that, you feel this tremendous weight lifted from your shoulders.
Graduating from Knoxville College in 1975, Ralph headed west to pursue his dreams. In 1975, Ralph Wiley, fresh out of Knoxville College, edgy and ambitious, arrived in California's Bay Area, a place with a reputation for radical political thought and action.
the Bay Area in the 70s, even into the early 80s, this is a perfect place for Ralph. He probably felt more at home there than any place he ever lived.
It was a culture that was vibrant, that was shaking up the rest of America, was challenging the nation on South Africa, was challenging the nation on racism, was not just accepting the status quo.
Everything was about pushing out the edges. We would argue that everyone was trying to expand everyone's consciousness. You know, the rest of the country were saying, you're trying to spread insanity, which maybe to some degree we were.
It was also in the sports teams in the Bay Area that had a wilder sense about them than anywhere else, and they too were rebellious at the time.
You were either a Raiders fan or you were an establishment fan. You were an A's fan or you were an establishment fan. You were a Warriors fan or you were an establishment. That was just how it was.
You could get a better contact high at a Warrior game than you could on East 14th and 98th Avenue. You know, the A's, if they weren't beating up each other, they were beating you up.
In Oakland, if you went into the bars, you could find two things without too much trouble, which were members of the Hells Angels and members of the Oakland Raiders. And the later it was, the more likely you were to find members of both of those fraternities.
It was in this turbulent environment that the 23-year-old Ralph Wiley first threw himself into journalism as a copy boy at the Oakland Tribune.
He was a sponge. He was learning from the writers who worked in the office. He read their copy. He might be running coffee for 10 minutes, and the next 10 minutes be back at his desk wondering, how would I write this story?
He was frustrated with what he saw in the paper. He knew he could do better. I said, take your time. There'll be an opportunity. And when the opportunity comes, grab it.
While bringing a fresh voice to the sports page, he was also a pioneering presence in the Bay Area's press boxes.
The press box, up until that time, was the most segregated arena in sports. You could go up to the press table at the Oakland Coliseum. I mean, you may as well be looking at a Ku Klux Klan clavern. There was nobody there but basically white males.
Throughout his whole time there, he'd had some opposition. There were some guys who, first of all, didn't take to a black guy coming in and walking with swagger, or a guy writing the way he did.
He was like the first generation of black ball players in baseball. They knew they were going to get pitches high and tight, and all they did was dig in harder. And I mean, you couldn't move him off the plate. So he was not going to be intimidated or overwhelmed.
I saw him rise in the eyes of the other writers from who's this guy to they began to call him the wizard. They recognized that this guy has skills.
There were not a lot of other Ralph Wileys floating around, certainly not in the Bay Area. You could cover up the top of the column and you could read five graphs because that's Wiley. I mean, you just knew that was the whiz.
Ralph's rise from copy boy to columnist within a span of 5 years was remarkable, particularly for the Times. He broke ground in so many areas, from being the only African-American beat writer in the Bay Area to being the only African-American columnist in the Bay Area. He was a real special guy.
It was as a columnist that Ralph was able to fully display his passion for boxing.
He was great at boxing because he loved it. He loved the commitment of it. He loved the passion of it. He loved that it was generally driven by men who came from nothing.
He knew what it was like to bump his head all the time. He knew what it was like to get beat down all the time. He knew what it was like, you know, to get knocked down and have to keep coming back. He brought that experience to boxing.
A young boxer named Sugar Ray Leonard was a particular favorite of Ralph's, despite strong opinion to the contrary.
Ray was not respected by many people in the sports world, in the boxing world, for his style. People didn't respect his style, but Ralph understood how good Ray was.
Leonard can afford to look delicate and act sweetly. We all know better now. In their due course, Roberto Duran, Wilfredo Benitez, Hearns, and Ayub Kalule, champions all, were sickened by Ray's sweet sugar. None of those fighters saw the end of the 15th round.
But the column that brought him to the attention of a national audience was about the much-fired manager and his overperforming team.
The A's had been sort of a dry, tedious, meh team. Then they hired Billy, and, you know, Billy was all full of old-time ball.
Billy was unpredictable. He would have double steals. He would have his players stealing home. It was just a real exciting time. And so Ralph, after watching them play for a couple times, just said, the way they're winning is Billy ball.
Billy baseball is stealing home. Billy ball says a squeeze play a day, keeps the shutouts away.
Billy Ball, A's baseball. Billy Ball, A's baseball.
That became the catchphrase. The A's wound up trademarking it.
And the A's owe him millions, and he won't see a dime. But the joy for him was, hey, I hit the phrase I wanted. I found the words. He got creator's pride out of that.
Anytime you have those kinds of skills, you're not going to be around for long, and it was inevitable when Sports Illustrated snatched him up and he was gone from the Bay Area.
In 1981, Ralph Wiley arrived in Manhattan, the fabled mecca of culture, commerce, and literature, to pursue his dream of becoming a great writer at a great magazine, Sports Illustrated. And along the way, break a few barriers.
There had not been anybody at the magazine like Ralph when he arrived. The magazine was four men and written and edited by men, and you might also add the qualifier white men.
Hiring Ralph was like dropping a bomb in the middle of Sports Illustrated. Here was this black man, strong voice, surrounded by a very white Northeastern culture that was set in its ways, and confronting this young kid who was like, what ways? These are my ways.
Ralph was coming in playing a different kind of horn, you know, and a different kind of rhythm and a different kind of melody, and it was discordant to a lot of people's ears. They didn't get it, and a lot of people didn't think it belonged.
They didn't understand the black experience, and they wouldn't take his word for it. There were times that, yeah, he would write black vernacular, and they'd want to put parentheses to explain to all of us other people what he was trying to say. And I know that was extremely frustrating.
Well, a lot of writers care very deeply about their work, and it's sort of part of the creative process, but this guy was a black guy, and you know, he could appear to be a little bit menacing, and I'm sure he scared a few folks over the course of the years that he was at Sports Illustrated.
He would equate it with working in the big house. They want me to live up in the attic or the basement, somewhere close to the master. He said, but I'm not one of those guys, and I'm not gonna let them change me.
He saw himself as very much not a part of Sports Illustrated, but he saw himself as part of a black society who he related to. He had a degree of intimacy with that's unmatched by any white sports writer.
Ralph liked going and getting them in places that nobody knew about, but people should have known about.
There's some people slip through the cracks, but that does not negate the impact that person had or the visionary that person was. And Big House Gaines is one of those guys.
Gaines has won more college basketball games than any coach in U.S. history who is not named Adolph Rupp. Only he and Rupp have won 800.
What people thought they knew about Eric Davis of the Cincinnati Reds before Ralph got to him and what they knew after Ralph got to him, it was like a completely different person.
Being a young kid coming from South Central Los Angeles, I felt like he could capture the essence of what my story was all about.
When Eric Davis was negotiating adolescence, he was so shy, he stuttered around strangers. His mother would tell him to slow down and think, and she reminded him that if no one else ever had confidence in him, she and his father always would.
Well, we was able to communicate so well that it wasn't even about an athlete or a reporter. It was almost like he was my big brother.
When I was at Georgetown, they started talking about it being paranoia and me being some kind of Darth Vader, calling me a racist, revolutionary, all that crap. Ralph thought we were being picked on or misinterpreted or not understood.
Arguments have and will be made against Thompson's methods, but nearly all his four-year players have left Georgetown with degrees. So far, none has ended up in drug rehabilitation.
Ralph found it funny that John was portrayed as someone who was intimidating. He was big and loud and black, which was left out. But that's what was understood and it's what was meant.
Part of Ralph's ability to see past the surface was certainly manifest itself in the way he covered Mike Tyson.
He found out why Mike Tyson was the way he was and why he scared people like me.
Tyson had often given people what they wanted in their conversations. If they wanted it lurid, he could conjure it, having grown up in the bloodhole belly of Brownsville in Brooklyn.
There's some things about Mike Tyson that are very obvious, but it's got to be some things that none of us know, and that's what Ralph would always be after.
I mean, we couldn't ignore the rage. You couldn't ignore the fact that
this kid was talking about punching somebody's brain in. I mean, that was who Mike Tyson was. But he was also the guy who understood history. Young Mike Tyson was a very erudite young man, and Ralph showed that in his writing.
He was a scholar of his craft. He would often watch a contemporary boxer and say he resembles so-and-so, say the middleweight Gene Fulmer or some other fighter out of the past, and be so correct, no one would disagree with him.
Ralph's groundbreaking work at Sports Illustrated served as an inspiration to the next generation of black sports journalists.
For those of us who actually read the magazine and hoped to aspire to be involved in, you know, sports journalism, you know, he was the guy who cracked the nut. He was the brother at Sports Illustrated.
He definitely gave someone like me, well, I mean, for lack of a better word, inspiration. That's why I was foolish enough to get into this business.
When you talk about role models, you're talking about somebody that sets the standard. They set an example. They show you the light, the way. And definitely that's what Ralph Wiley did for me.
But the most important mentoring that Ralph Wiley would do would be with his son, Cole, born to Ralph and his wife, Holly, in 1982.
So often we see young black men without that confidence in an academic setting because they're fighting from behind. Ralph made sure Cole wasn't going to have that.
He wanted me to be a Renaissance man. He emphasized literature. Like, he would buy me books from time to time, say, you should read this. There's some good lessons in life that you can learn from this. He would tell me to read some books by James Baldwin or Mark Twain.
Ralph realized that the most important thing he was gonna do was raise a responsible, intelligent young black man, and he made that his number one priority.
He always told me that I was special, that I was talented, and that I should be doing, if not as much as he did, more.
To read the best of Ralph Wiley's sports writings, pick up a copy of Classic Wiley from ESPN Books with a foreword by Bob Costas and an introduction by Michael Wilbon. Classic Wiley is available wherever books are sold. In 1989, Ralph Wiley was assigned to write a story for Sports Illustrated on Raheeb Rocket Ismail, the sophomore sensation from Notre Dame.
I was the managing editor at the time, and Ralph wrote a terrific story on Rocket with really great insight on what goes through the mind of a college superstar contemplating his life in the NFL.
But Ralph's relationship with the Irish star didn't end with the publication of a cover story. For in Rocket, Ralph saw an opportunity to shatter harmful assumptions.
Here were all these black athletes suddenly making millions of dollars, but they themselves didn't think that their money would be managed right unless a white man was doing it.
It was a sore spot with Ralph and with several other blacks as well. I submit to you that if the NBA was 85% Korean, the agents would be all Korean. It was a slave mentality that we were still retaining that, quote unquote, if you want it done right, get the white man to do it for you.
That belief system definitely permeates through the African American community. Ralph Wiley obviously was on a mission to debunk such assertions.
Ralph says, we've got to break this chain. We've got to start trusting and believing each other. We got to put that money back in our own communities. He said that every minority that came to this country has done that.
He had a plan, he had a strategy. Ralph pulled together Team Rocket, and he also orchestrated the whole Rocket Ismail deal.
He mapped out and laid it out, and if we do this, we do this, we do this, we do this, we'll get this.
Every step of the way, Ralph would suggest something, and Rocket would think about it, it sounds good, he did it. And it worked out very well for him.
He has signed a 4-year contract, which could be worth, with incentives, up to $26.2 million.
It was a huge deal for black agents, because suddenly black athletes were saying, well, you know, maybe I should take a chance on this guy. He's done pretty good. And there are a lot more black agents today because of Ralph willing to take a chance and change that perception.
Shortly after we published the story, I learned that Ralph had been acting as an advisor to Rocket Ismail without having disclosed that relationship to us at the magazine. which was really a very, very clear violation of any organization's journalistic ethics. We had a contentious encounter over this fact, and Ralph didn't seem to entirely get why this was improper.
Ralph said, well, you, and I'm moving on. Because at the time, he had built his national reputation enough so that he could go on his own at this point. He didn't need them anymore.
Ralph's noisy departure from the staff of Sports Illustrated freed him up to explore whole new fields of writing.
A lot of us, we find something we're good at and we stick with it because we're afraid to go somewhere else and to try something else. And Ralph wasn't afraid. The good writers can write about anything. And Ralph was a good writer.
He really enjoyed the freedom to write a whole range of different kinds of books. His first book, Serenity, a boxing memoir, was really a book which deserves more attention and was a really eloquent, beautiful memoir. It was also very much a book about sports, as well as a book about growing up.
When I was a boy in the barbershop, one name came up louder than the rest. It was Cassius Clay. There would be a great deal of murmuring assent and an occasional derisive sneer that a real tough guy would eventually show the kid what for. Probably Liston. And then someone would say, Liston won't see what hit him, and neither will you.
But it was not long before Ralph's writings turned from the personal to the political. In a series of books and essays, he tore into the issues of an era dominated by race and justice.
What you're looking at from the black perspective is the rise of conservatism and the era of Ronald Reagan. Now there's a new America where we don't have to deal with these issues of race and black people and all that tension. It's morning in America, a new day, we're moving on. And for a lot of black people, it was a thumb in the eye. It was as if white America was turning away, and an invitation then for black people to say, we've got to reassert our own identities and ourselves as separate from white America. And you get a new sense of militant, angry black voice and a new sense of racial tension.
So we are locked in a life and death struggle. Only one of us is going to survive.
You've got all of this stuff going on, and all of a sudden, he writes a book why black people tend to shout. And you're saying, well, is he angry? No, he's telling you there's cause to be angry.
The party of Ronald Reagan made being a greedy, race-baiting, irresponsible politician cool, at least to many people, with predictably disastrous results.
When you're a black man and you're willing to stand up and tell the truth, you're considered radical and contentious.
This was a very confident black man who was very, very comfortable with his voice and where he stood. And he wrote a couple of essays on integration versus segregation, and those are brilliant.
Ralph recognized that integration, as it came to be conceived and defined and in fact implemented, demanded the destruction of anything that was all black or even predominantly black if it emerged out of the era of segregation.
What do you get with integration? You get the decline of every single black institution, from private black colleges and universities to black social groups to families and entire communities. You get the decline of every single one of them but the church. And if you're not careful, even that's only a matter of time.
My father owned a drugstore that I often call the Black Happy Days because it had the jukebox, it was the after-school hangout. Those institutions disappeared. They disappeared because we were so happy to be able to have the right to shop and take our businesses anywhere we wanted that, you know, we forgot to appreciate what we had. And before we turned around, many of those institutions were gone.
And I think that's the one thing I really respected about Ralph is that he really understood that trick bag. He understood the whole dilemma of quote unquote progress.
Ralph's exploration of the ironies of black life in America prompted a mutual friend to introduce him to filmmaker Spike Lee.
There was Coach Thompson, who was in his heyday there at Georgetown, that they said, Spike, you need to get with Ralph Wiley.
Spike is just as crazy as Ralph is. Both of them are guys who can be very outspoken. And both of them are strong in their convictions about things. And I thought that if they didn't kill one another, they'd love one another.
That relationship was cemented on the set of the film Malcolm X. Ralph wrote By Any Means Necessary, a companion book for the film and in the process, help Spike realize his vision.
We were of that generation where Malcolm would have a deep influence, you know, how we thought, how we viewed the world.
It was a dream job because it was life's passion, man. I mean, he would have done it for a nickel. And Ralph threw himself in it full force, a labor of love.
Ralph Wiley is part of that intelligentsia working with Spike Lee that's asserting we're going to protect the Malcolm X legacy, because the Malcolm X legacy is about the quintessential defiant black male of the second half of the 20th century.
And cut.
You know, it was a very tough film to make. There'd be times, you know, where we have him going through some rough spots. Ralph would write me a letter, keep going. F those MFers.
I don't know of one black person in the United States of America that has not seen Malcolm X. Every black person I knew, they ain't just gonna see the movie. They went to see the movie that opening weekend.
Malcolm X spoke about institutional responsibility, about personal responsibility.
When the Negro, the so-called Negro in America, gets on God's side and listens to the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, he'll want to get off of drugs. He'll want to get away from a life of crime. He'll want to get away from committing adultery and fornication. Then he would want to get off the welfare. He would want to get a job.
He would actually say, quit looking to white society to do things for you, for your children, for your families, that you black men should be doing for yourselves.